few chapters, okay? You know the very basics. When you want to write a comment, you use the hash sign. After hash sign, everything is a comment. For example, here we have a statement, a is equal to 48/10. And then somewhere in on the line, I have a hash sign, and anything after hash sign is a comment, okay? So I can write a statement followed by a comment. Of course, you cannot write the statement after hash sign. Anything after hash sign is a comment. In Python, we have several data types. The basic data types in Python are integer numbers, float numbers, complex numbers, strings, and Boolean. There are five basic data types. The float numbers can be something, if you write, for example, 12 and point, it becomes, it is, this is equivalent to 12.0, okay? 12.0 and 12 point are identical values. They are float numbers. But 12 alone is integer. And 12 and 12 point can be compared. When they are compared, they will give you equal, okay? If you have a variable A is equal to 12 and another variable B is equal to 12.0, they will be equal. If you compare them, they will be equal, but in reality, they are not same, okay? One is integer and the other one is float. But when you compare an integer and float with the same value, it will be okay, no problem. You can write strings in four different ways. You can either start by a single quotation mark and finish with by a single quotation mark, or you can start with double quotation mark, double quotation mark, or you can start with triple double quotation mark and end with triple double quotation mark, or you can start with triple single quotation mark and finish with triple single quotation mark. When we do this, this print T1 produces this result. Okay, this is the result of the print T1, because in T1 we have backslash n, which is new line character. So after printing Ali, Kaan, blah, blah, it goes to the next line here and prints the rest. So usually we either use single quotation mark or double quotation mark. When we use triple quotation mark, triple double quotation mark, if inside the string we have, for example, again, a single quotation mark and a double quotation mark, then I can use triple quotation marks. In this case, I can freely use single quotation mark and double quotation mark inside a string. We have variables in all programming languages, almost all programming languages. There are very special programming languages that may not have the variables as we know from Python. But anyway, almost all programming languages have some variables. In Python, a variable name or an identifier, we call them identifier. The identifier can be either a variable name, can be an object name, can be a function name, or can be a class name, okay? A class name, object name, variable name, function name are all some strings which that we call identifier. In Python, an identifier can contain uppercase or lowercase alphabetical characters, A to Z in uppercase or lowercase. It may contain also underscore, and it can contain digits, okay? But there is one important rule. A variable name cannot start with a digit, okay? It can contain a digit character inside a variable name or an identifier, but the identifier cannot start with a digit. So anything starting from with an alphabetic character or underscore is acceptable. For example, A or Z or A or Z. And by the way, the variable names are case sensitive. So uppercase A and lowercase A are two different variables, okay? We can use two different variables or two different identifiers, okay? So when we write lowercase z, when we use lowercase z, it means that we don't use yet the uppercase z. They are two different, they will be two different variables. Here I have, for example, underscore a, 8. It starts with underscore, this acceptable. But 8a is not acceptable because this 8a, in 8a, the first character is a digit and the first character of a variable name cannot be a digit. Here we have a minus, it is not allowed. Here there's a space character is not allowed. And sign is not allowed, cap sign is not allowed, etc. Only allowed characters are alphabetic characters, 0 to 9 digits, and underscore. We know this already. There are some Python keywords, okay? In a program, we cannot use variable names or function names or object names or class names using those Python keywords. For example, we cannot create a variable name named if or not or pass or class. These are all Python keywords. So the Python keywords cannot be used as variable names or identifier names in a Python program. To change or to assign or change the value of a variable, we use assignments. The basic assignment symbol is equal sign. When we have in basic assignment statements, we have a variable on the left-hand side of equal sign, and on the right-hand side, we have an expression, such as, for example, let's write here something. Let me just look here if I've... This is, which chapter is it? This is chapter 2.4. So what I will do, I will create, I will just take this one, file, save as 2, let's say, Python intro. Let's create a Python intro program. Python basics. Let's put a comment here. Let's erase all of this. Okay. Now, sorry. Let's put here Python basics, and I will start with assignments. Let's create here some values. A is equal to 7, B is equal to 4, C is equal to A multiplied by B. Now I have three assignments. In the first assignment, in each assignment, by the way, I have the equals operator as assignment operator, and on the left-hand side, I have a variable, and on the right-hand side, I have an expression. The first expression contains only a constant, an integer constant. The second has integer constant. The third one has a multiplication operator, okay? What happens in all cases, the right-hand side is computed, calculated, and assigned to the left-hand side. 7, there is nothing to compute here. 7 is directly stored into variable A. In the second statement, in this statement, on statement 7, B is equal to 4, there is nothing to compute, that we have a constant on the right-hand side. The expression only consists of a constant, and that's stored into B. And here we have a multiplication. The value of A is taken, the value of B is taken, they are multiplied, and the result is stored into C. So this equal sign is the primary operator. Let's write some other operators, a is equal to plus equal 1. What does this mean? This is equivalent to a is equal to a plus 1. When we have something like this, let's put it here. When we have something like this, we just first, in mathematics, of course, a is equal to a plus 1 is not possible. But it's not mathematics. This is a computer programming statement, computer program statement. And here on the, we just don't look to the left-hand side. Omit this part first. Just look to the right-hand side. There is, after a equals sign, we have a is equal to a plus 1. So we take the value of a, which was 7 originally, add 1, we get 8. And we assign the value 8. The calculated value is assigned to the variable, to the variable on the left-hand side. So this is perfectly valid in a computer program. And when we have a is equal to plus equal 1, it is equivalent to this one. Here we can have, for example, c minus b. What happens? We will just take this c minus b, okay, copy this, put a parenthesis here, and put there. Oops, sorry. This is equivalent to this one. Why did I put parenthesis? Because there may be this kind of situation. If there I have asterisk, no problem. That's okay. But I may have some more complex b divided by 3 multiplied by 5, for example. I take all of these, okay, control C, put into the this. Here, first of all, this expression, C minus B slash 3 asterisk 5, is computed, and then the result is added to A, and then the result is stored into A, okay? So that's why we are putting this. First of all, this expression must be computed. That's why I put here a parenthesis. And then the result of this expression is added to A. So plus equal is for that. We can have minus equal. In this case, this plus becomes minus. It can be multiply equal. Then this becomes multiplication. Or this can be divide equal, then here we will have division operator. Or this can be floor division equal, then this will be floor division equal. Or the last one is we can have here percent, which is modulus operator. Am I correct? Because I am teaching various computer courses, sometimes I mix when I switch from one computer programming language to another one. Okay, there is this one, no problem. What is this? We compute this value. This is percent is modulus operator or remainder operator. In this case, we check when this is divided by that value, what is left? After the division, we get the remainder and assign a remainder this value to a. Okay, and lastly, we can have here power operator. What we do, we compute this value. We take a to the power this value, and then the result is assigned to a. So we have how many? Apart from the normal assignment, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 more assignment statements, okay? Therefore, we have in total 8 assignment statements, plus we have one more for string concatenation, okay? Which is, equal, again, plus equal. But anyway, we are now dealing with numbers. Okay, this is about assignments, you know these, so I will move quickly to type conversion. By the way, if there are any questions, please interrupt me and ask your question so that we there will be nothing to that is not understood in those subjects which were covered in CS 101. Type conversion. What is type conversion? We had told that we have several data types in Python: integer, float, complex number, string, and boolean. Okay. Sometimes we may need to get an integer out of a float, or sometimes even we may need to get an integer out of a string. Assume that we have, for example, s is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4. I have a string here. This is not a number. I can, if I just do, for example, s2 is equal to s plus 10, I will get an error message. Let's try to print s2. When I try to run this, I will get an error message. Why? Because here I get an error message. Because for this plus operation, the first operand is a string, the second operand is a number. A string cannot be added to a number, or a number cannot be added to a string. So what I can do, I need to convert this to an integer. If I really want to do an arithmetic operation, an addition, I have to get from this string a number. So I have to convert this string to a number. How do I convert it? It is quite easy. If I put here int, if I use the int function, the string is taken. It only contains digits, and it is converted to int, integer. The int function call here gives me 1,234. So I can add 10, and I can print it, and I will get 1,244. Okay, no problem. Or otherwise, what I can do, I want to convert 10 to string and add append to the end of this string. I want to do a string manipulation. So what I can do, s3 is equal to s1 plus int 10. Oh, sorry, str 10. I want to convert 10 to string. And append, do a plus operation. Now s1 is a string. 10 is a number, but with str function, I converted the type, the integer type, to a string. I have, after this, I have, this is c equal to 1, 2, 3, 4 plus 10. With str 10, I get this string, and when I print them, I will get this. Come on, what is wrong? No, this is not S1, of course, this is S, sorry. Okay, here I have 1, 2, 3, 4 as a string, 10 as a string. When I use plus operator, then plus operator here is not addition operator. Addition operator is only valid for numeric data. Here I have strings, so it's a concatenation operator now. It concatenates the string before the plus and the string after the plus to get a new string. This is a string, this is not a number, okay? If I want to use this as a number, what I have to do, s4 is equal to, for example, int s3, and do something with that, /100, for example. Now, let's go back to our lecture notes. So we were talking about type conversion. There are several type conversion functions. The most used ones are int to convert to an integer. We can convert to integer a real value. For example, let's assume that x is equal to 14.867, and I have x int is equal to int x. What happens? this int x converts this float number to integer, what do we get? Of course, as you will probably know, we will get only 14. It will discard all the fractional parts, and we will get 14 as result. Or we can have a string which contains some float number. Let's say v is equal to float, and we have a string which contains, for example, something like this. Okay, so we have, this is a string, and it converts this to string to a float value. When we run this, we will get, of course, this was a string. The string is converted to a float number, and it is printed as you see here. So we will use mostly int, str, and float, but there are some other type conversion functions. For example, to convert an integer to an octal string, or to an hexadecimal string, etc. We have some functions. Assume that we have, for example, b is equal to this number. I want to convert binary. Let's write binary. Binary is, let's check if binary is a reserved word or not. Is there any reserved word named binary? Let's check here. There is no reserved word named binary. So I can use binary as a variable name. Is equal to, or not binary. Yeah, let's leave it as binary. Is equal to, let's see first what hex produces. Hex of B. X1. I cannot name my variable as hex because hex is a function name. Okay, so having hex is equal to hex b will be wrong. So what I do, I just put here and one, and then let's print hex one. This is hexadecimal value of 32,767. 0x is for hexadecimal representation. If a this is a number, okay? When we have 0x in Python, it means that it's an hexadecimal number, and 32,767, as you see, is 7FFF, okay? And let's check if there is a binary, a function to convert to binary, bin. Yeah, here, I was looking for this. Let's use here bin 1 is equal to bin of b, and print bin 1. Let's see what will happen. As you see, 0 and b is for binary representation of a number in Python. As you see, these are all ones. I deliberately chose this number. I knew that it will consist of only ones, but let's change this number to something else, 10,000, for example. Okay, let's see what is the 10,000 in binary. In binary, it is 100111000001 and 4 zeros following that. Or if we have, for example, 1024, it will be only have one and 8 zeros, no, so 9 zeros following it. No, 10 zeros. Yeah, 10 zero following one. So this is 2 to the power 10. So one followed by 10 zeros in binary. Anyway, so we will mostly use float, int, and str, but there are some other type conversion functions that can be used. About basic input and output, we have used print. The most basic output statement is print. If I want to get something from keyboard, then I will use input function. A is equal to input, and you put here some string, enter anything. I just put a space so that on screen it's not just attached to the prompt. And here, print A. Let's run this. Enter anything. I'll just enter anything. Okay. Some mixture of, even let's put here space and comma, blah, blah. Press enter. As we see, here it is output. Okay. The things that I've entered are printed. This is the content of A. If I want to read a number, what I will do, then I will use type conversion and input together, because input only gives us a string. If I run this again and enter only a number, this is entered. I entered this, but this is taken by input as a string. Input gives us a string. So what I have to do, I cannot, for example, enter, let's say a number, enter, or let's say even enter first number. Let's go here, copy this, enter second number, which is B, print A plus B. Let's run this program. Enter first number, 40. Enter second number, 32. Did we add the two numbers? No. Why? Because input reads things as a string. This is also reads the entered things as a string. So this becomes string concatenation. String 40 and string 32 are concatenated to get this. So what I have to do, since this gives me a string, I want to get a number. So what I do, I put here int parentheses so that now the string given to me by input function is converted to integer. Input gives me a string. I put the string inside the int function, inside as a parameter to int function, and I get an integer value from this string. Now, if I run this, let's again enter 40, 32, I have 72, which is now what I want. So here we are using type conversion, because input gives us the input data as a string, not as a number. If I want to have some int, I use int. If I want to have a float, I will use a float here. Now let's run this. 40.7, 2.1. So what will the total? 42.8. Of course, we have here some extra stuff. This is because the internal representation of float numbers have some complexities, and sometimes you can get this kind of stuff. Don't worry, in scientific usage, in engineering usage, this part will be negligible. So that, and probably there will be no problems in your programs. Let's continue with my lecture notes. So here we have input, int input and float input to get a string, an integer value and a float value from keyboard. About output, about print, there are several important things. Here we have A, B, C, S, blah, blah, several things. If I put print, let's move this here. Print A, B, C, for example. Okay. Let's take this statement. Let's go here. We have A, B, and C. Let's go here. And what I will do, I will choose this part, right click, comment out. Now, I just commented everything out. So this became it all. What I did, I just chose those statements, right click, and I just say comment out region or uncomment out region. It will remove the hash sign in front of them. When I want to comment out region, then it makes all of the statements as comments that will not run anywhere. So it will not be too much crowded. So let's come back here. I have A, B, and C. When I do print A, B, C in Python, it will print the value of A, the content of A, put a space, content of B, put a space, content of C. Let's put here, for example, S1 is equal to A, B, C, D. S2 is equal to C3 P O. And let's put here S1, S2. Here in my print statement, there are some numbers and some strings. It doesn't matter. It will print everyone, every parameter, but it will put a space between them. A7, after 7, before S1, it will put a space, it will print a space, and then S1, it will print S1, and then after S1, it will print a space, and then after that, B, etc., etc. Let's run this. We see that 7, A, B, C, D, 4, space, blah, blah. All are separated in space. Of course, if I have here, for example, some space, output, of course, there will be more space, because at the end of this string, there is a space. Before C3PO, there is another space, so those spaces are printed. But other than that, between each parameter, there is a space printed. Okay, what happens if I want to print, not space, but something else? I want to print them without any space. I use sep is equal to the double quotation mark with nothing between, okay? This is an empty string. We call this an empty string. Sep is for separator. This is instead of comma, the separator is printed. Between A and S1, a space was printed. Between S1 and B, a space was printed, etc. Now, instead of printing space, I said print nothing. So what will happen? All are printed without any space. Or I want to put a comma between them. I want to print a comma between them. So there are comma printed there. Or a comma and space between them. I can have more than one character. Instead of a single space, I printed space and a comma after each item, between each item. Okay. Or I can have here, for example, space XXX space blah blah, something, anything. Then this will be printed there. There's something like this. Now that separator is printed between each item, okay? And another thing is that print second, next line, or let's say next line. Let's print this string after that. When we do that, we see that next line is printed here. Why? Because print after printing its content, with default separator space, or we can change the separator to something, some other string, then it prints a new line at the end of the string. So it goes to the next line. What if I want to suppress this? So I use and. And means, and the default value of and is backslash n. Backslash n inside a string is new line character. Instead of printing a new line character after that content, we say print nothing, what will happen? It will stay on the same line. Now we see that next line is just printed after C3PO. Between A, S1, B, C, S2, the separator are printed, and at the end of the after printing everything, if the end is not specified, if it is not specified, it prints a new line. It goes to the beginning of the next line. But I can change this, and I can have, for example, instead of one line, backslash n, two lines. Okay? Instead of printing only one line, I put two lines, so it will go to next line and next line again. Therefore, there will be an empty line between them. So I have a control to print what between the items and to print what after all items are printed. The default is one space here, and the default for end is backslash n. These are the defaults, okay? If you don't put sep and end, the default for sep is one space, and default for end is backslash n, which is new line character. So we have this, or let's go back, run this, and we have same output, as you see. We can change the separator between the items in the print list, and we can change what is printed after printing everything. If I want, for example, to have here something like this, I will have that, okay? This is about basic input and output. Do you have any questions about the subject so far, in about chapter two, the basic syntax, the data types, variable names, how we make the variables, what are the resort words? These are keywords or resort words. These are resort words. You cannot use this in your programs. How you do assignments? What are type conversion functions? And how basic input and output or print and input functions are used? Any questions about these subjects so far? Is everything understood, or did you know everything that I explained? Is it fine?
It was clear, teacher. Thank you.
Clear okay. For me.
Okay, then. Then we can proceed with the next subject. In the meantime, I want to check if I want to check my syllabus, data types, variables, assignments, type conversion, operate. We finished up to here. Now let's continue with operators.
Teacher, are you gonna share us to these words, these folders? Are you gonna share these folders to us?
In LMS, let's go to LMS. I changed the abbreviation to CS104ME202. Or you can find with CS104. Here, there is Python lecture notes. This lecture notes, okay, this document can be downloaded from LMS. And after I finish this, I will put here, I didn't put it yet. I will just create another item here. Let me do it, turn everything on. Let's go here, add an activity or resource. I will just go here. I will create a folder. The name of this folder will be Instructive Python Programs. Okay. This will be this will contain some instructive Python programs, mostly those that we will examine during the lectures, okay, that I will write during the lectures. So what I will do, activity completions, when you view this, okay, save and return to course. Now it is here. I will move this to here. Okay, after the lecture is finished, I will put here that program. And you can check. The first few programs will not be too interesting. But after a while, I will put some very really instructive Python programs. So you can download those programs by clicking here. Now it's empty, there is nothing. But eventually, okay, let's put here edit. And let's go here. Let me go to Python intro. Okay. Okay, now I've put Python intro. You can just download the whole folder, or you can download a specific program by clicking on it. Okay, there are two ways of doing it, downloading the whole folder or downloading an individual program. So from here, you can download my lecture notes. You can click on this and it will be just start a download operation. You can it will be a good idea to download this practical programming and introduction to computer science using Python 3. This is a very good Python program and Python textbook. Please download this to your computer. And here there is a Python cheat sheet, a beginner's Python cheat sheet. Download this one as well. If we would do this course in university in the classes, then during the exams, the midterm and final, I would allow you to use this cheat sheet. I will show it to you. Books. This is a quite nice. Where it is? Xerodox. Where did I put this Python cheat sheet? Of course, this is not CS101. This is CS101. Books. Yeah, this is a very handy two-page document. Page one and page two, or page three, page four, it had more pages, page five, etc. It has several pages anyway, and it is not too long. I don't know how many pages there are. Let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. It is about 26 pages. Yeah, there are 26 pages. It contains almost everything related with Python. The first few pages is about variable strings, lists, tuples, if statement, dictionaries, etc. While loops, classes, functions, where are for loops anyway. It is not in the same order as we will go throughout the semester. But anyway, it contains everything compact in 26 pages. So you can download this document as well from here. So I'm presenting to you lots of material. Here there is Python tutorial sites and exercises sites. From here, you can go and study by yourself from these tutorial sites. I put here 6 tutorial sites and 2 exercises sites. These sites contain some very interesting exercises. I sometimes take a question or not from these exercise sites and ask in exams, but because some of the questions are interesting and good, not all, but anyway, and some questions are difficult, they are advanced questions, so you can use these tutorial sites and exercise sites when you study alone. So in our course, there are lots of material to study Python, okay? Plus, I have a YouTube channel from which you can watch some Python lecture videos. There are not much, but there are some Python lecture videos there. I have Java lecture videos and Python lecture videos in my YouTube channel. Most of them are lecture recordings, okay? There are very few specifically prepared videos, but most of them are lecture videos. But anyway, it may be useful to you. So there are lots of pages here, lots of material, lots of resources that you can study. when we will do, when we will make the quizzes, when we will collect the homeworks, etc., you will get some grades, and here I will announce the grades, okay? Under the grades part, here there will be the grades for the quizzes, midterms, homeworks, etc. And this is the place that to look for the grades. When the time comes, I will give some announcement about that. The grades for homeworks will be graded in the homework part. Here in week four, probably there will be a homework starting from week four. Or maybe we will assign the homework on week three, and you will submit sometime on week four the first homework, and then for every 2 weeks there will be another homework, and the homework grades will be announced in the homework itself. But I will collect them and put into the grades here, because when I compute your overall grade and assign your letter grade at the end of the semester, I use my own spreadsheet that I put here, a copy in grades part. If there is any differences between a grade in a homework part and the announced grade here, please write an email to me. I may just copy something wrongly. So if there is something wrong, then please write an email to me. If there is any differences between grade in the homework and the grade in that are announced in the grades section. So let's continue with, we have come to operators.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, you can.
I didn't understand assignment parts equals equals percentage part.
Okay. Let's do a simple, more simple example, then it will be more understandable. Okay.
Thank you so much.
Okay. Now, A is, let's say, 20, and B is, for example, 7. Okay. When we say A percent equal B, okay, what does this mean? The meaning of this is that A is equal to A percent B. Do we agree on that?
Yes, teacher.
Okay. What is A? 20. What is B? 7. What is the remainder of 20 when divided by 7? 6. Okay, so A will be 6. Let's print. You'll see that A is 6. Okay.
Thank you so much, teacher.
You are welcome. But instead of B, it could be, for example, B floor division 2. B is 7. Floor division 2, what is the result of this expression? I don't need to put parentheses here because there is B is 7. 7 divided by 2 with floor division gives us 3, okay? 20 modulus 3 is 2. There are 6 times 3, 18. Up to 20, there are 2. So when we run this program, I will get 2 as A, okay? Here B is 7. 7 floor division 2. Gives us 3, the value integer 3, and 20 modulus 3 is equal to 2, so I have the 2 is assigned to A. Another question? Okay, I will continue with operators and I will finish my lecture for today. Next week I will explain if statements, for loops, while loops, and functions. Because you have seen already those things last semester. Okay, what are the operators? Let's make this slightly bigger. First of all, we can use plus and minus as unary operator. There is plus and minus, which are arithmetic operators, but we can also use plus and minus as unary operator. What do we mean? I will just explain it with an example. Assume that I want to have here C is equal to A multiplied by minus B. Here, this minus is a unary minus operator. It is not a subtraction operator. It just makes this B negative, okay? So B is 7. As we know from here, A is 2. 2 multiplied by minus 7, okay? Here, this minus is unary minus. Here, instead of minus, I can have plus as well. Usually, we don't use unary plus. The default is unary plus anyway, but we can use unary minus. This is an example of that. Or we can have minus A multiplied by B. This minus is a unary minus. Whether I put here a space or not, it doesn't matter. This is wrong. Let's remove these statements. It had some S1 and S. I removed S1 and S2. Those statements contain S1 and S2. So, okay. Here, as you see, we didn't print C. Let's print C. A is 2. 2 is printed. B is 7. Minus A is minus 2. Multiplied by 7, minus 14. As you will see, we get this. So this minus is not a subtraction operator, but unary minus operator. Usually, when we use unary operators, we don't put any space. As an experienced programmer, I always put a space before and after operator, except the unary operators. Okay, unary operators are written, it is better to write in without any space with unary operators, but with binary operators, binary means there are two operands, one before and one after. I always put a space before and after all binary operators. Here, for example, this is a binary operator, a silent operator. There is something before and something after it. And here, with multiplication operator has something before and after. I always put here spaces. If I don't put any space, then it will be difficult to understand what is this. Minus A, asterisk B. Our brain spends less time to understand this expression rather than that one, okay? This is more difficult to understand at the first sight. You have to spend maybe half second, 1 second, but with this one, it is much quicker to understand what is written. So that's why I prefer a space before and after each operator. If I write, for example, if statement A greater than B, here before this greater than operator, I put one space and one before and after. If I don't put any space, I find this more confusing. It is the same thing. It is perfectly correct, but this makes our brain eye-brain combination understand this more quickly. Okay, that's why I use space before and after each operator. Anyway, let's go back. Let's remove the syllabus. Arithmetic operators, we have seen plus, minus, multiplication operator, division operator, floor division operator, modulus operator, and you know the power operator. Let's do a power operation. A is equal to 2 to the power 10. You know now that it is 1024. Print A, it will print 1024. Oh, of course, this is the power operator. We have 7 arithmetic operators: addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, floor division, modulus, and power operator. We have 6 comparison operators or relational operators. In order to compare two things, if A equal equal B. In order to compare two things, we use double equal, because single equal is a silent operator. Okay. When we do this, what it will do? It will assign B to A, and it will check. As you see, there is something wrong here. This is not correct. The Python will give me. Let's put here print something anyway. When I try to run this, it will give me an error here. So when to compare two things, we have to use two equal sign. Also, we can use to check if not equal, we put exclamation mark and equal sign to check if they are not equal. If A and B are not equal, this will give me true. If I want to check if the first value is greater than the second one, I use greater than sign. If I want to check if the first value is less than the second one, I use less than sign. If I want to check if the first value is greater than or equal to the second one, I use greater than equal together. Don't put a space here. Okay, you can put a space, but it is not. This is one operator. It has to be written together. And if I want to check if the first value is less than or equal to the second one, then I use this operator. There are six operators, six relational operators or comparison operators. There are three logical operators or Boolean operators, and, or, and not. If A is less than or equal B, or B greater than 20, for example. As you know, the OR operator, for the OR operator, we have to consult the truth table for OR operation. In OR operation, if any of the operands, here there are two operands. This is the one operand, and this is the second operand of the OR operation. Here, from this comparison operation, we get either true or false. From this comparison operator, we either get true or false. And then we have true or false, or true or false. When any side is true, the OR operation gives us true. If both are false, then the result is false. Otherwise, it is true, okay? So we have to know the truth table for logical operators. If I have AND operator, both sides must be true in order to get a true result from this expression. If A is less than or equal to B is correct, is true. If B greater than 20 is true, then this whole logical expression is true, otherwise it is false. Okay. If anyone is false, the result is false. If both are true, then the result is true. Except it is not contrary, but in OR, if anyone is true, the result is true. If both are false, the result is false. But in OR, both have to be true in order to get a true result. We know this already. I didn't put here. I have truth table for logical operators. False, 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 true, true, false, false, true, true. In A and B, both has to be true in order to get a true result. In A or B, if anyone is true, either first one or the second one, or both are true, the result is true. If both are false, then A or B is false. So you know this truth table. You have to know this truth table quite well. So we have these operators that we will use. These operators, of course, we have assignment operators that I have explained already. There are some bitwise operators that we will not cover at all. There are five bitwise operators. This is shift left operator, shift right operator, bitwise invert operator, bitwise not operator, bitwise AND operator, and bitwise OR operator. There is AND and OR, logical AND and OR, and there are bitwise AND and OR. I will not go into details. Maybe some of you may know if you have done a binary AND operation or binary OR operation or binary NOT operation. Anyway, there are some bitwise operators that we will not discuss in this lecture.
Teacher, why are we bitwise operators?
In engineering programming, the bitwise operations are not used much. In computer science or some specific applications, the bitwise operations are done. But usually in engineering applications, bitwise operations are not done much. We will most frequently use logical operators AND and OR very frequently. But that's what we chose because it's not used too much. I wrote thousands of programs. I rarely use bitwise operators. Okay. Anyway, let's continue with. If you want to learn about this, you can go to those tutorial sites and learn about them. Okay, it is quite easy to learn about them. But I will not teach those. What else? I explained AND and OR. Yeah, precedence is quite important. If you have an expression, something like that, for example, let's put here A is blah, blah, this minus and parentheses. Let's assume that we have not only A and B, but several variables. A, B, C, D, E, F is equal to, there are six values, 7, 2, 4, 3, 9, 6, for example, okay? And assume that I have an assignment. A is equal to B minus a parenthesis C plus D multiplied by E power 2, for example, divided by F minus D. Let's put here another parenthesis E minus A, for example, okay? A, B, C, D, E, F, okay, we used almost everything. Now, let's put here a comment. Here, when we have some complex thing, what are the rules to calculate this or to evaluate this expression? Of course, we can have something like that. Take this, copy, if A plus B less than 20, or we have this, the whole stuff, okay? Assume that we have this expression. This is quite nice. And here, assume that if we have this. Anyway, now, how do we evaluate this expression? Here we have a weak expression. Here we have a logical operator. We have comparison operator here. Of course, let's put here another comparison operator. Greater or equal D minus A. There are two comparison operators, one logical operator, and there are many arithmetical operators. Here, what is the order? Okay. When we look to the in order to evaluate this expression, I have to know the order of operators. First of all, at the bottom, you see logical OR. The logical OR has the lowest priority. If I have, for example, here, if A greater or equal to B, and OR C multiplied by D equal to 10. And let's put another thing, some more simple thing here, e less than d. Print something. Here I have or and comparison. Of course, here I forgot this. And some comparison operators, two logical operators, etc. You should know that OR operator has the least precedence. So at the OR operator will be evaluated last. Before OR, there is AND. And at the top, there are arithmetic operators. The arithmetic operators has higher precedence than other binary operators. And at the top of everything, we have parentheses. If there's any parentheses, we have to evaluate parentheses. Here, for example, there's a parenthesis. But inside this parenthesis, there is another parenthesis. So what we have to do? We have to evaluate first this parenthesis. A is subtracted from E. We get a value from here. And then we compute the rest of the parenthesis. And here inside this parenthesis, we have power operator, which has higher precedence than others. If you look here, the second one is power operator, and then we have unary plus, unary minus, and bitwise not. Forget about bitwise not. Unary plus and minus operators, we don't have any unary operator here. So let's make this something like this. I will just narrow this so that I can see the document behind. Come on. What happened? Yeah. Now, from here, from this table, I know that power operator has higher precedence, so e to the power 2 will be computed first. But if here there was a parenthesis, f divided by 2, floor division by 2, then before this, in order to evaluate, to compute the power, I have to first find the result of this. So f floor division 2 will be computed, and then e to the power, that value will be taken, because parenthesis has higher precedence, okay? And then since there is no unary plus, unary minus, we skip that. Then we have multiplication, division, floor division, and modulus at the same level. So from left to right, in this expression, we have something like this. After evaluating this, we find the value of that. We found already the value of that. Now we have left with plus, multiplication, division, and subtraction, which have higher precedence. Multiplication and division has higher precedence. Now from this part, after evaluating the power, we have a value here. So let's write here the precedence of operators. First of all, we have to do this, okay? Also, we have to do this parenthesis, 2. After this, we have to compute this, 3. This is computed, this parenthesis computed. E to the power, the first value is taken. And now we have left with multiplication, division, plus and minus. So we have to do this multiplication and this division, which have same precedence. When they have same precedence, we go from left to right. There is one exception, but let's not confuse you. And after that, we only have left this plus and minus in this parenthesis. So since plus and minus have equal priority, we continue with plus. This is done at the sixth place. Then after that, this minus is evaluated. Now, the whole parenthesis is computed. So we can, yes, I'm listening.
Double division is much more precedence than the double multiplication, or they are the same?
Which one? Multiplication, division,
yes,
floor division, okay, and modulus have same precedence.
Okay.
Okay. They have all same precedence. If they were different, if they had different precedence, they would put on different lines. Okay. For example, all these have same precedence. Okay, understood. Plus and minus, addition and subtraction have equal precedence. After that, now the parenthesis is finished. We have a value from here. Then we can do this 8. Then we finish all of these. Okay. And similarly here, we can have, we can do this. Okay, let's say this is done. This part is finished. But before, of course, before doing this, maybe we should start with this one, one, then this one will become two, three, etc. But let's not confuse it. We have finished this one. Then we want to compare this. In order to compare this, I have to do this. So here we will have 9. And after this, we can compare these two. Let's put here 10. Now we have result of that. Of course, before that, we had to do this. Let's call this 1. A plus B is added. A value is found. Now, since less than has higher precedence than OR operator, this has to be done. A value is found here. It is compared. And for after the operation 2, we have here either true or false. A plus B less than 20 results as true or false. And when we do all the operations here, as we have put, after this greater than or equal operation, we have another true or false from here, and then true or false, or true or false, we get a result. Let's go back to this one. Here I have this plus operator, this multiplication operator. So let's say that this will be done first. Is there any other arithmetic operators here? No. The next level is comparison operators and logical operators. Comparison operators are have higher precedence. So this will be done after that. 2, 3, 4. Okay. A greater than or equal to B is computed. We have true or false from here. This was already computed at the first place. Then the result, that result is compared with 10 for equality. We get either true or false from here. We get a true or false after the fourth operation, the less than comparison operation. We have now true false here, true false here, and true false here. We only left with OR and operators. And when we look to the table, AND has higher precedence. So this is done after that. So true or false and another true or false. This AND operation is done here. We get a result, a true or false from here. After the AND operation, we get a true or false. And then lately, we have the OR operation that will be performed. Is this understood?
Yes, clear.
Okay, thank you. Yes. So, you don't need to memorize everything, but at least you have to know that if there are any parentheses, first the parentheses have to be computed or evaluated, and then exponent or the power operator comes next, and then multiplication, division, floor division, and modulus operators comes after that. Addition and subtraction comes after that. Let's skip the bitwise operators. We will not deal with these. After addition and subtraction, then we have our comparison operators. I will show you is not in, not in, etc. Later on, okay? I will show you these operators later on. They have the same level of precedence with comparison operators. In is to check if something is in a list or in a tuple or in a dictionary, etc. Is checked for to check the type and some other things. I will show some examples about these in the future. Anyway, these are less used than this. In is sometimes used more frequently than is, if to check if an element, a value, exists in a list or in a tuple, we will use in. And then we have logical not, followed by logical and logical or. For example, if I had here not operation, okay, I put here not operation. Then what will be the order? Before and, before or, we have done the multiplication first, then the comparison operators 2, 3, 4, and we have or, not, and. What we will do here, we have a result, okay, either true or false from this expression. Then not is will be followed, it will be 5. After not, we have or and. And has higher precedence, 6, and or will be done last. Okay, so I can have something like that, or not. Not is connected with the following logical expression. It converts the logical expression, the following logical expression from true to false, or from false to true. Okay, so if I give you something like this, and if I give this kind of selections, you can, or if we were doing the exams in class, I would give you as questions something like this, and you would have to write those numbers. But I will think how I can ask this kind of questions when we do online exams. Anyway, I will figure out something like that. Okay, this is the end of our lecture for today. Any questions so far?
Thank you, teacher.
Teacher.
Yes.
There will be only one day this lesson, isn't it?
Yes. Every Tuesday from 2 to 3:30, approximately, we will spend about 1.5 hours every week, because in distance education, 1 hour is equivalent 2 hours class lecture, okay? So 1.5 hour is equivalent to 3 class lecture hours. So 1.5 hour is quite sufficient for us to conduct the lectures in good order.
Only Tuesdays, okay.
Only Tuesdays from 2 to 3:30.